Now it's working. A bit too hard. Good morning and thank you for attending the class Judging the Friesian Horse. My name is Jolanda Slootjes. I've been a judge for the KFPS for 20 years already. And my English won't be perfect today, but I will compensate it with enthusiasm and knowledge of the Friesian horse. And we're with a small group, so it's like a private class. So there is a lot of room for questions and comments. I won't read everything being presented on the PowerPoint. You can read it yourself. I will give the additional information because I think you can all read, and it's my time is too precious to read it out to you. The program is saying, how do I judge my mare? But actually, the way we judge mares, stallions or foals, 1 year olds or 2 year olds, are always the same. We have the same way of judging all those horses. And making progress in your breeding has to do with knowing your own horse, knowing the good points and the lesser points. And if you want to breed, you can find a stallion who can lift up the lesser points of your mare. And therefore, it's very important that we see a lot of Friesian horses, because with that we collect all the data, which makes it available for the breeders to know how the Friesian stallions are doing with their offspring. Very important, of course, the breeding goal. This is one I will read out loud. Functionally built agility horse possessing the Friesian breeding characteristics, that is healthy and vital, has the aptitude to perform in the sport, has a reliable character and good trainability. Well, that says it all. And hopefully, if you have a Friesian horse in your barn, this is the thing that horse goes for. This functionally built, of course, the typical Friesian breeding characteristics, healthy and vital, also very important for breeding. Of course, you want to perform with your horse in sport, recreational or on a higher level, and a good character and trainability. The terms, the themes of the breeding goal, of course, we have the exterior, the sport testing we have, the character and health and vitality. Yes, there we are again. Of course, we all know the exterior, the five things we look at when judging a Friesian horse. Very important, the breeding type, the breeding characteristics. Then we look at the conformation, the build of the horse, the legwork, very important, both the stance and the quality, the movement, both walk and trot we judge during the inspections, and character, it says here character, but if a horse isn't behaving well in the arena, it can be sent out of that, because one of the most important things of the Friesian horse is, of course, the character. But we won't give any points for that. The Friesian horse is a racial breed, meaning it has to show that all the characters are which are required for the breed. And for breeding characteristics, we look at, first of all, the color, the hair, the manes, the tails, the feather. The head is very important, and of course the neck. All those things add up for the breeding characteristics. Oh, here we are. Of course, this picture is a perfect example, a horse with a jet black color, nice long hair, a beautiful small head, a noble head we call it, and a nice, actually, because of all the manes, we don't see the neck very good, but we can see it's a long, upstanding neck. The head should be small in comparison with the rest of the horse, with small ears, preferably tipping a little bit towards each other, big, shiny eyes, the nose bone preferably a little bit ditched, with big nostrils and a good mouth. Also important with the head is that the jaws aren't too heavy, because often then you get a heavier head-neck connection. The head-neck connection is the part behind the ears That's the pole of the neck. That should be long. The distance from the pole to the jaws should not be too long, and the jaws should not be too heavy. Then you have a light, good head-neck connection, which makes it easier for the horse to bend during the work. Oh, this is actually what I said. I did it right. Here we have some examples for a lesser noble head. You see the nose bone, it's almost with number 14, a Roman nose, and the small ears, not enough expression in the head. Hopefully we get a better example later on during the slides. The neck and the pole are long. The neck is the long neck. The pole of the neck is the small part behind the ears. And we like to see an upstanding neck, not too vertical, but definitely not too horizontal, with enough length and with a nice arched, a nice shaped neck. All that makes it a beautiful, for the breeding characteristics. The head-neck connection should be light. Also, the length of the neck should be long enough. The stance, as I said, should be almost vertical. And of course, a nicely shaped neck. And the crest of the mane should be strong enough. Here we have some examples of the head-neck connection with number 28. You see a very short pole of the neck, heavy in the jaws. And if this horse needs to bend, he has trouble with that. The other horse has a very light head-neck connection. You can see the space behind the ears is long enough. The jaws aren't too heavy. This horse has room to breathe. Here you also see the different, actually they have made these pictures with all the same horse, but you can see definitely the differences between which is light and which is heavy. The length of the neck, very important, because for the breeding characteristics, a nice upstanding neck is like the jewelry on the horse. We like to see it long. Of course, in the compensation with the rest of the horse, also with the stance of the necks, we like to see a vertical neck, not too horizontal. The shape of the neck, we like to see an arched neck, not a U neck, not too horizontal, and also straight isn't good because we like to see the arched. The swan neck, you often see that in pictures with stallions, but if that's a natural stand for the neck, then it's not the thing we want to see. We have some lesser necks. The first horse has, of course, a very short neck. Also a heavy head-neck connection because of the pole of the neck, which is too short. And you see with the other horse, the arch should be on the upside and not on the downside of the neck. Here we have an horizontal neck and a too vertical neck. If the neck is too vertical, it's also not easy to let the horse bend enough during the work. The U neck, you can see there's bulging underneath the neck instead of a nicely arched neck on the upper side. Same with the other picture. And also the second picture shows a not so beautiful nasal bone. The crest can eventually fall. That is not nice to see. It could be, you can train it a little bit, but when it's actually fallen, you can't get that straight anymore. Actually, I have a paper here. You can all write down your email address. I will send you this PowerPoint so you can look at it again, because we're not going to go through all the sea lines or fallen crest. Of course, feathers is very easy to see. We like to see a lot of hair, both in the mane, tail, and socks. Length and thickness is very important. And of course, the color. We like to see a jet black Friesian horse, but we know we as judges are often a little bit fooled because often horses are being dialed in a jet black color. So if your horse is a little brown, we don't take that too much into consideration. We think you keep your horse in a healthy barn situation, let the horse get out. So if your horse is a bit brown, that won't be a problem during the judging. But of course, it's nice to see a nice black horse. Faded black, all Friesian horses are black. We would never call them brown. We called it faded black. There are no white hairs allowed on Friesian horses, except for a very small part of white above the line of the eyes, but it's no bigger than 3 centimeters. So it's a pity, but if you have a horse with white hair, not allowed, it can do very good in sports, it can be your best friend, but it can't be taken into the stud book. We don't make the rules, we only have to obey the rules, and this is what the stud book has given as rules for that. And of course, in total, for the Friesian expression, we like to see an elegant outline. You probably have heard the term baroque, meaning round and curved shapes. We don't like to see a little bit too thick horse, but we would like to see fluid lines, especially with the upper line. With conformation, very important, we like to see a good, strong built horse. First, we look at the general expression. We like to see a harmoniously built horse, all in comparison with strong connections. Often the Friesian horses are built a little bit downhill. We would like to see them built a little bit more uphill, but the average Friesian horse is a bit downhill. We would like to see long lines with long legs, good muscles, good condition, and enough youthfulness. Often we judge the 3-year-olds if they have an appearance of an older horse, that is not preferable. And of course, the modern appearance. Built in proportions, meaning that all quarters should be more or less equal. And we like to see a rectangular model instead of a square model, because if the horse is long-lined, it's probably more, shows more suppleness and shows more bending during the work. Here we see the direction of the body, as I said. Often you see Friesian horses built a little bit downward, preferably is horizontal, and we hardly ever see an upward built Friesian horse. But that is what we like to see during improving the Friesian breed. Oh, and of course the goal is to race in the forehand. We often think if we have a horse with a good conformation, the conformation makes it easier for the horse to present themselves in the way we like to see. So if it's built a bit more uphill, it probably will move a little bit more uphill because he has the qualities for that. Here we have the difference between a classical Friesian horse and a modern long-lined Friesian horse. Often people say, well, we would like to see the older Friesian horses as they were 20, 30 years ago, but obviously those horses didn't move that well as the more modern Friesian horses. We like to see long legs, because then the horse presents themselves better, makes it also easier for the gates, for the extension of the gates. And make sure if you buy a horse and if you buy a horse from a picture that the photographer always helps a little bit with the lines of the horizon. But you can definitely see the difference between these two horses. One is built perfectly in proportion, otherwise he or she wouldn't get an orange ribbon. And the other horse is definitely short-legged. The conformation in details, also, as I said, head-neck connection and neck are being judged during the breeding characteristics, but it's also very important during the conformation. So the head-neck connection and the neck, we take in consideration the shoulder, the withers, the whole top line, the loins and the croup. So as I said, the head-neck connection should be light, we've already seen that, the neck should be long, with a good direction and a nice shape. Well, we have some examples here from the neck, coming low or high from the crest, high from the crest, and of course here a low from the crest, a short neck and also very horizontal and heavy. The shoulder should be long and sloping. It's difficult to judge the shoulder if you're not used to that, because you need to have a little bit x-ray eyes. But you can see the shoulder lying in this picture, but also of course with a horse in front of you, and you can see the length and the direction. Often the Friesian horse has a little bit a steep shoulder, but we like to see it more sloping with enough length. Here you can see the differences between steep and sloping, but as I said, you need to train your eyes a little bit to find where the shoulder is. The top line. Top line is very important because that gives the horse suppleness, and that's often the place where we sit on when we ride the horses. It needs to be strong, it needs to be well developed, and it needs to be fluid. Here we have a very nice example of a good top line. Also, the withers should be well developed, and they should flow, go smoothly into the back. Here we have the withers. It's better if you have a little bit high withers, because then the saddle stays better in its place. Here we have a little bit too high developed withers, because then you see the top line isn't that fluid anymore. The other picture has some flat and short withers, and there you can see often the saddle going from one side to another. The back, of course, as I said, should be strong, well-muscled, long enough, and good in proportion. Also, the connection with the withers and with the loins should be strong. We don't like to see a tight back, and keep in mind, the back is only the little space between the withers and the loins, so you can have a horse with a top line which is a little weak, but the back actually can be straight. So make sure that you take everything in consideration. The top line is the whole top line of the horse. We have the withers, the back, the loins, and the croup. But if it's all into good comparison, then you have actually a fluid top line. This is something we don't see often, luckily, because this horse has a way too far straight back and loins. You often see that if a horse is in pain. So this is an example. If you see this, this is definitely not good. The first, the big picture, the back is very long and too weak, and especially also the loins could be better developed. Also the smaller picture above, definitely a weak top line. And the other picture has a very straight top line, especially on the loins. Here we have some more loins. If you want to look at the loins, the development of the loins of the horse, make sure you stand close to the shoulder. Then you can see on the back of the horse how wide the loins are. We would like to see strongly developed loins, good muscle, because we have the croup, of course, which is the engine. The horse should go more uphill. The loins are the transition. So here you see the shape of the loins again. They can be tight, correct, and too weak. And then often you also see the connection with the back, with the loins, which is not strong enough. The croup is very important, and the same thing for the croup goes as the same thing for the croup. You need to have a little bit x-ray eyes. You look at the hip bone and the sitting bone. We as judges aren't allowed to feel where the bones are, but you can see it if you train your eyes a little bit for that. The hip bone and the sitting bone, we look at the direction between those two bones and also the length. We like to see a little bit a sloping croup with enough length. Often the croup is a bit steep, but as I said, we like to see a big engine, and that means that the croup should be a bit sloping with enough length. Here you see the bones of the hip and the sitting bone. The distance between number 2 and 3 makes the length of the croup. The average Friesian horse has a little bit a sloping croup. If you have a mare with that, you can look at the information of the stallions and find a stallion, of course, who can compensate that a little bit. It's not mathematics, but it's worth a try to improve your horse. Here you have the sloping croup. You can actually see, especially on the bigger picture, the hip bone and the sitting bone. You can see it's going real down. The legwork, very important. We judge 2 things during the legwork: the quality of the legs and also the stance. And we look at all 4 legs for that. We need to look at the legs from the side, from the front, and from behind. First of all, very much reading. You can do that all when you're at home, when you have the presentation. First of all, the quality of the legwork. We like to see clean legs, no puffiness on the joints. We are no veterinarians, but often if you see fluids with the joints, there is some friction in the joints. The joints are making more synovia. So we would like to see hard, dry legwork, clean legs. The opposite are puffy legwork. Very important is to look at all the joints if you see some puffiness, some balls with fluids in it. Here we have some leg defects. Some of them are serious, some of them we don't take too much into consideration during the inspection. As I said, the judges don't make diagnosis in the ring, but you can you can visit your veterinarian for that. And very important, with quality of the legs, the most important part to look at is the inside of the hock. If you have puffiness in the inside of the hock, you often have a problem with ball spasm. So make sure if you ever buy a horse or see a horse, look at the inside of the hocks. All the other puffiness aren't very much appreciated, but that is really a problem. If you have a horse who has the inside of the hock too full with fluids, it won't be taken into the stud book. Okay, well, that's good, that's good. No, it's very good. This is the hawk. And it's very important to stand at the side of the horse and look to the inside of the hawk. If you have the book Judging the Friesian Horses, there are some awful examples of that in it. But it's very important, and don't ever, if you have a seller who tells you, well, that's no problem, and it gets rid in a few weeks, don't believe it. Don't ever buy a horse with an inside of the hock with fluids. The stance of the front legs should be straight underneath the body. Often the Friesian horse is standing a little bit under. Also looking at the front of the legs, you see a horse can go toeing out, toeing in, but we like to see the horse going straight. And actually we look at that when the horse comes in walk towards us. We would like to see some length, space between the 2 hooves, because otherwise the horse is too narrow-based. The correct stance of the legs, you can see here with toeing out and toeing in. Look at it when the horse is walking towards you. The hind legs, we look from the side. We don't like to see too much bending in the hind legs. We call that sickle hocked. We would like to see, of course, there needs to be a hook during in the hind legs, but not too much, but definitely also not too straight. Here you have an example of a sickle hocked horse and a horse with a straight hind legs. straight hind legs has to do with the durability. There needs to be some flexibility in the joints. And with a straight hind leg, you have that less. Also, the hind legs we look from behind. Same thing goes with the front legs. They need to be straight underneath the body. You often hear us say cow-hocked. Luckily, we don't see a lot of bow-legged horse. Often, the foals are a little bit cow-hocked, but don't be too much alarmed about that, because often during growing, that will straighten out. We don't like to see the pasterns too weak, also not too straight. And the feet, of course, very important for the horse. We would like to see that all feet are equal, and we would like to see them with a good size and well-shaped. Often your farrier can help you with that. Then, very important during judging the Friesian horse is, of course, the movement. Judging the Friesian horse in hand, we can only look at the walk and the trot, because we don't do the canter during the judging by hand. Movements, it needs to be regular. There needs to be a good tact and rhythm with enough scope, enough length in the passes. Power, of course, the balance. Balance goes upwards, but also sidewards. The use of the body's suppleness, also using the top line in a good way. Reach from the shoulder, the capacity toward transitions, and a nicely aptitude for moving forwardly. The breeding goal of the walk. The walk is a regular four-beat gait. All feet are taken up equally, placed forwards with the same length and the same strength. And it must flow through the whole body. We would like to see suppleness and a nice use of especially the shoulder with enough length in the passes. Very difficult often to understand is what is a regular walk. Of course, if a horse is lame, that's easy to detect, but what is a good four-beat gait? If you hear a horse in walk on a hard footage, you can hear four different beats. The hind leg sends away the front leg, meaning that the front leg should be lifted a little bit before the hind leg comes. If you think of how a camel walks, you can picture that in your mind. That's a typical lateral gait. They move at the same time. And often it looks as a very good walk, because often a lateral gait gives a lot of length in the passes. But that is definitely not what we like to see. We would like to see length in the passes, but with the good four-beat gait. So keep in mind, the front leg should go a little bit faster, lifted from the ground, when the hind leg comes close to the front leg. And you can train your eye on that. If you see the second viewing this afternoon, look at the walk and try to see if it's, well, they all are star stallions. You won't see any lesser gaits, I hope. Also, for the breeding goal in the trot, very important is, of course, first of all, regularity. The trot is a two-beat gait, meaning the legs land on the footage and have a good moment of suspension. During the trot, we would like to see the hind legs brought far enough under the body with strength, bending in the hocks, and of course also for the trot goes suppleness, movement throughout the body, enough length in the passes, and we would like to see the horse go uphill. And of course they can only do that if they have enough strength in the hindquarters and the ability to bring the hind legs far enough under the body. The difference between pushing and carrying, You often see the hind legs going behind the body, but we like to see the hind legs coming underneath the body, because that means that the horse has the ability to carry himself and hopefully also carry the rider more. You can look during the trot and also during the walk, the casken. The casken is a very good to look at if the hind legs are coming far enough under the body. If that comes almost vertical or vertical, that means that the hind legs are taken far enough under the body. And with a pushing way of trotting, the casken stays too far horizontal. That is something you can actually do this afternoon, because you see a lot of caskens coming vertical under the body with the second viewing star stallions. And of course, if the horse can carry himself during the trot, he can easily carry the rider, because he actually brings his hind legs underneath the place where the rider sits. Here you have a picture. You can actually see it in a picture, a downhill trot. The forehand should be going way more uphill, and the hind legs should come further underneath the body. As I said, we don't judge the canter during the inspection by hand, but we can see, of course, the canter during the aptitude test, like the IBOP or the ABFP testing. The canter has a 3-beat gait, the feet land on the ground, and there is definite a big moment of suspension. The front leg should have enough reach, the hind leg should come under the body. And of course, especially for the canter, balance and suppleness is very important. As I said, only in the aptitude test we can judge the canter. But of course, the canter is very important if you have a horse for your pleasure and your use for sports or whatever. The breeding goal of the character is not something we can judge, but you as owner probably think that's the most important feature of your Friesian horse. The horse should be reliable. It should be a pleasure to work with. It should be trainable. Often they have a very pleasant character and they are always willing to please you. And that's very important that the KFPS keeps that in the breeding goals, the perfect character. We always say the Friesian horse is a true family horse. The breeding goal isn't to go to Prix St. George or the highest levels in sport. It's of course very nice if some of the Friesian horses gain that goal, but that's not the goal of the Friesian horse, of the KFPS. It should be a pleasant horse, vital, healthy, and willing to please and able to keep the work. The studbook acceptance. If you go to judging with a fall book horse, that can be a gelding, a mare, or a stallion from the age of 3 years old. They are judged by us, and they will make a linear score form for the horse. We judge the horse on 5 different things, as I said: the breeding characteristics, the conformation, quality and stance of the legs, walk, and the trot. Keep in mind, movement is more important, so both walk and trot count twice. During the linear score, we look at the horse, and for different items, we compare the horse with the average Friesian horse, and we will look at your horse and will think, is this horse less than average, average, or better than average? If it's average, we score a 25. If it's less, we can score lower, or if it's better, we can score higher. Keep in mind that some of those items are need to be average. If you look at the hind legs, you don't want a high score, you don't want a low score, you want an average score. If you look at the trot, for instance, or nobleness of the head, you want to see the highest score possible. So if you have a linear score form from your horse, you know what we think of your horse compared with the average Friesian horse. And that's definitely the most difficult thing if you want to judge Friesian horses. You need to compare them with the average Friesian horse. You need to see a lot of Friesian horses. But keep in mind that the Friesian horses you often see are better than the general population, because you go to the stallion show, you go to the central mare show, you go during the breeding days, during the championships. But if you sit in the morning at 8 o'clock at a normal inspection, you see that the average Friesian horse is not as good as what you see these 3 days. And also for us as judges, we need to keep in mind that we don't see all the Friesian horses. So we think we see the average Friesian horse, but the real bad horses won't go to the inspections, because it takes money, it takes time. So if you have a horse which is not, if you already know if it's not good enough for taken into the stud book, you won't present it to a judge. So we give scores for the breeding type, the conformation, the legwork, and both walk and trot, and as I said, the walk and trot count twice. We give scores from 4 to 9. It's not the same as during school, but if you score a 4, it's not good enough to be taken into the stud book. A 5 is better, but also not very good. 6 is satisfactory. 6.5, keep that in mind, is average. And a 7 is more than satisfactory, an 8 is good, and a 9 is very good. If you ever have a score of 9, that's the highest we can give. If you have your horse scored for one of the items with a 4, it won't be taken into the stud book. If you have 2 5s, same thing goes, horse can't be taken into the stud book. Even if the horse has a 9 for the trot, if you have 2 5s or a 4, unfortunately, it won't be taken into the stud book. If you have a 6, your horse will be taken into the stud book without a premium. 6.5, the average score of the Friesian breed, which we see during the inspections, gives a stud book with a 3rd premium. If you have a 7 in general, it's been taken into the stud book and becomes star with a 2nd premium. From a 7.5 or higher, your horse is taken into the stud book with a 1st premium. So how can you make progress in your breeding? As I said, very important is always look at horses. Wherever you go, it doesn't even have to be Friesian horses, but train your eye how to look at quality of or stance of, for instance, legs. Because all horses need to be clean and dry, need to have clean and dry legs. If you ever go to dressage testing, doesn't matter which kind of horse it is, look at the walk. First of all, check if it's regular. If you like to walk, and then try to figure out for yourselves, why do you like to walk? Is it active? Has it enough bending, suppleness? Make sure you train your eye, and of course, look at your own horses. I always say your own horses are the most difficult to judge, because you always see something, and then you always say hallelujah, and it always turns out a little bit different. But so make sure that you look at your horse, be honest, and get your horse inspected, because then you get your linear score. And with your linear score, if you want to breed, if you have a mare and if you have the intention of breeding, you can go to the KFPS site, or also in the different countries you all have your own chapters. You can log in and you can actually find out the stallions who can improve the things your horse scored lesser on. So we collect all the data, and we do that with a lot of pleasure. We travel all over the world. We also judge the Friesian horses all over the world in the same way. If you have a Friesian horse, for instance, becoming star in South Africa, it's the same quality as a Friesian horse you get become star here in Friesland. So all horses are being judged in the same way. with the same people. We have a small group of judges and inspectors, and we all judge them the same way, so make sure that you use the information we collect for you. So if you want to learn more, as I said, write down your email address. I will make sure you get this PowerPoint. And I think a lot of people already have the books judging the Friesian horses. They are like a Bible. You can find everything in it. And if you have any questions, check with your local chapter or email the KFPS. We're always willing to help you with it. Well, thank you. Are there any questions?
Yeah.
Moment of suspension.
But
yeah.
In walk, if the horse doesn't have a walk, it doesn't have a walk. I can do small things, but I can't change it.
You are actually right. You are actually right. Yeah. You are actually 100% right, and also the walk is the lesser point of the Friesian breed, so it's very important for us to keep that very high and very well judged, so we can improve the walk of the Friesian horse. But as you said, the trot is often very spectacular. During the stallion show Saturday, you won't see an upstanding applause for the walk, but people all recognize a good trot. So make sure, as you said, the walk is very difficult to improve. So make sure that if you are going for your stallion selection, find a stallion who gives a good walk. They all are beautiful, they all present themselves well, but especially the walk, if you have a mare with a lesser walk, make sure you find the stallion. Perhaps it's not the champion of the stallion show, but make sure you look at the breeding goals of the offspring of the stallions, which brings a good walk. It can be a bit excited.
And they get excited and they don't want to walk that well and it's difficult. I know that. It's much easier at the trot because they can let the excitement out. But I think the judges should put more of an emphasis on ensuring that the walk is clean.
Well, that is actually what we are doing, what we are always doing. The horses often are given also more time for showing off a good walk. First of all, they come in as with the fall books, they come in as a group, so they can relax a little bit more with each other and get acquainted to the arena. Then they show the walk during the individual inspection, and afterwards, if they come back for premium, we also let them walk in the group, so we give them the most possibilities to show off a good walk, because we know how important the walk is. Now, it's for us as judges, it makes no difference if the horse is barefoot or has shoes. But often you see the training stables shoe the horses because they show a little bit more expression during the trot. So that's often why they use shoeing on the horses. But for us, if it's a good trot, it's a good trot, whether or not the horse is shoed. Any more questions? If you see us somewhere during these days or during an inspection, come and talk to us, have questions. We always like to talk about Friesian horses till boring or almost. So make sure if you have any questions, we are very approachable and always willing to talk about Friesian horses. So thank you. And enjoy the rest of the days. Oh yeah, of course, I have here two forms. If you want to write down your email address, we will make sure that you get the PowerPoint. Okay.